Hello and welcome to the National World War II Museum's podcast series, Service on Celluloid. Service on Celluloid is brought to you through the generous support of the Albert and Ethel Hertstein Charitable Foundation. My name is Seth Paradin, historian and digital content manager here at the National World War II Museum in New Orleans, and this is our mini-episode where I will continue our discussion on the 2002 film, The Pianist. The Pianist is a biographical film based on the experiences of Polish-Jewish pianist and composer Władysław Szpilman. The film begins with the German and Soviet invasion of Poland in 1939 and follows through the remainder of the war, focusing on Szpilman's struggle for survival after he is separated from his family and put into the Warsaw Ghetto. Szpilman participates in the Warsaw Uprising, goes into hiding, and is eventually discovered by a German officer who helps the talented piano player survive the rest of the war. The Pianist stars Adrian Brody as Szpilman, Thomas Kretschmann as Wilhelm Hosenfeld, and Maureen Lipman. The film was directed by Roman Polanski, produced by Polanski, Robert Ben Musa, and Alain Sard. It is based on the book by the same name, written by Szpilman. The film was widely praised and was a financial success. Adrian Brody received the Academy Award for Best Actor for his role.
It took away everything. It took away our right to walk out on the street or without they can kill anybody, hang you on a tree. The invasion was horrendous. The people, some of the people who were disillusioned with government, who suffered in the hunger, in the depression, you know, we had 10 million people die in Ukraine. So they were waiting for Germans. But they found out too quickly that it means death. They had no rights at all.
That was the voice of Zhanna Dawson. Zhanna, a Ukrainian Jew, was a child concert pianist who grew up in the Ukrainian city of Kharkov and was imprisoned by the Germans after they captured the city. We'll hear more from her in a bit. This film focuses on the trials and tribulations of Władysław Szpilman, as I said, as he gets tossed into the horror and turmoil of the Warsaw Ghetto and the murders that surround it. Ghettos, Jewish ghettos, were more common than most people think. When people think of ghettos in World War II, they generally think of only two, Warsaw and Krakow. But it's an astonishing fact that the Germans established over 1,000 Jewish and Romani ghettos in Nazi-occupied Poland and the Soviet Union. The very first Nazi-established Jewish ghetto was set up a mere 38 days after the invasion of Poland, so it's very clear that they had plans to do this long before. Tribunalski was quickly followed by Tulislaw and Lodz ghettos. Ghettos were constructed in cities such as Krakow, Bialystok, Lvov, Lublin, Vilna, Minsk, and Kovno. As we discussed a bit in the main episode, ghettos were usually confined areas in larger cities. And by confined, I mean most of the Jewish ghettos were walled off, straight up walled off, by either a brick wall that was constructed by the Germans or barbed wire, more often than not, brick walls. Any Jew found outside the ghetto at any time could be subject to execution, and they were. Living conditions within the ghettos varied from ghetto to ghetto, but generally, they were appalling. People were crammed into spaces that were entirely too small for three or four people, much less a dozen or more. In Warsaw, over 30% of the population of the city were Jews. That 30% were crammed into an area less than 2.5% of the city's area. 400,000 people were crammed into an area 1.3 square miles in size. This left an average density of 7 people per room. Other ghettos were worse. In the Odrzel ghetto, 700 people lived in an area that was originally occupied by 5 families. That left an occupancy between 12 to 30 people per room. Naturally, in such close confines, disease spread rapidly, sanitation was virtually non-existent, and food was scarce. Because of the restrictions placed upon them, Jews were not allowed outside the ghettos, as I said earlier. If they were found out there, they were immediately killed, which meant that any real foodstuffs had to actually be smuggled into the ghettos themselves. The average ration per day in Warsaw was a mere 1,125 calories per Jew. Jewish diaries that survived the ghettos, which are few and far between, told of children starving in the streets, children literally laying in the streets, starving to death, begging for any kind of food that they could receive, and there was no food to be handed out. And I'm talking about children young as 3 and as old as 9, 10, 11 years old. Starvation, and as I said a minute ago, disease, were the major killers in the ghettos. In Lodz alone, over 43,000 people died of supposed, quote, natural, unquote, causes. 76,000 died of, again, natural causes before the end of summer of 1942. 83,000 died in the Warsaw Ghetto from 1940 until mid-1942. And I say natural causes, I guess starvation could be considered a natural cause, but not when it's being inflicted on you on purpose. In the following oral history clip, Zhanna Dawson talks about how she was forced to move out of her home in Kharkov and live in a ghetto. Let's hear what she has to say.
It was horrendous. The people were hanging on the street, and they didn't care. They hung the paper saying that if anybody has anything to do with the Jew, both sides will be killed immediately without any questions or anything. Can you imagine what they made the Jews into? Now, it just proves to you what can be done by the millions of words with madmen that they can convince, they maybe can convince one day the world that the Jews are capable of doing. The Jews actually are not worrying people. They don't do it. They are musicians and doctors. I will say that. That's what I knew. And they are humanitarian people, but it was horrendous because one day it was already, you see, we were taken into the ghetto. We were taken there for 2.5 weeks only or so. They never had a crumb of food for us. And the water, they gave us 2 or 3 times. They took us in a long line to wait for a little water. People were dying, you know. Don't talk about the bathrooms, please, because that's an insult, the worst possible thing. There was a lot of terrible laughter of Germans watching the Jews walk to their death. They were enjoying it. I think that they probably signed up that they would be doing it, and the right people were sent to do it. There was no consideration, no help from any side. When people were isolated, they put an announcement everywhere. The Jews are to be gathering in some spots at such a time to take only what they can carry on themselves. We thought of the idea that we would take a slave because it was winter, it was cold, it was a very cold winter. But we did have a slave. But when we got to the place where we were supposed to gather, it was already midday. And the sun started to melt the snow enough so that it was useless. They stood there, took pictures, and had fun. That, I remember, is the most hideous, most horrible thing of all. As I say, not the hunger and not the fear, none of those things I remember with such despise the human heart, you know. What can you do?
The main purpose of the ghettos was organization. By squeezing the Jewish population into one area, it was thought that it would be easier to transport the Jews to their final fates. As a result, most ghettos were not around for long. Most of the ghettos, Warsaw being one of the exceptions, were razed and liquidated by 1942. Lodz was the last Polish ghetto destroyed in late 1944. But back to the Warsaw Ghetto, and in particular the Warsaw Uprising, which is a big part of this film. From July 22nd until September 12, 1942, German SS and police units, assisted by auxiliaries, and these auxiliaries usually consisted of Ukrainian volunteers or former Soviet prisoners of war, carried out mass deportations from the Warsaw Ghetto to the Treblinka Killing Center. During this period, the Germans deported about 265,000 Jews from Warsaw to Treblinka. They killed approximately 35,000 inside the ghetto during the operation. In January 1943, SS and police units returned to Warsaw, this time with the intent of deporting thousands of the remaining approximately 70,000 to 80,000 Jews in the ghetto to forced labor camps in the Lublin district of the government general. This time, however, many of the Jews, understandably believing that the SS and police would deport them to the Treblinka killing center, resisted deportation, some of them using small arms that they'd smuggled or captured from the Germans inside the ghetto. After seizing and murdering approximately 5,000 Jews, the SS and police units halted the operation and withdrew. On April 19, 1943, however, their withdrawal changed. A new SS and police force appeared outside the ghetto walls, intending to liquidate the ghetto and deport the remaining inhabitants to the forced labor camps in the Lublin district. The ghetto inhabitants offered organized resistance in the first days of the operation, inflicting casualties on the well-armed and equipped SS and police units. They continued to resist deportation as individuals or in small groups for 4 weeks before the Germans ended the operation on May 16, 1943. The SS and police deported approximately 42,000 Warsaw Ghetto survivors captured during the uprising to the forced labor camps at Poniatowa and Traniki and to the Lublin Majdanek concentration camp. At least 7,000 Jews died fighting or in hiding in the ghetto, while the SS and police sent another 7,000 to Treblinka. The voice we heard earlier on this broadcast was that of Zhanna Dawson, as I mentioned earlier. A piano prodigy, Zhanna began taking formal lessons at the age of 5. By the age of 6, she was playing Bach on Soviet radio. Zhanna was captured in Kharkov in 1941, following that city's capture by divisions of the Waffen-SS. Not long after the city's capture, the Jews of Kharkov were rounded up, about 16,000 in total, and marched out towards a ravine to be summarily executed. Zhanna and her younger sister escaped and lived in hiding for the next few months. Through the help of friends, she was able to obtain fake documents that claimed her name was Anna Morozova, a non-Jew, and put in an orphanage. An orphanage official heard Zhanna playing the piano one day and offered the young teenager a job playing music for the occupying German troops. She accepted and began to tour Germany, ironically enough, and occupied Eastern Europe, playing in front of German generals and other officials all across the Reich, even in Berlin. After Nazi Germany's defeat, the young pianist who had disguised herself as a Russian, well, she was a Russian, but she disguised herself as a non-Jew, was placed in a displaced persons camp and eventually made her way to New York, married David Dawson, and went to the Juilliard School Musical Conservatory. Traumatized by her experiences, she never spoke of the war or the Holocaust until her son asked a random question about living in the Soviet Union during the war. That was in 1978, and it was the first time since the Holocaust that Zhanna spoke about it. In 1990, she answered a letter from her granddaughter regarding her experiences, and ever since then, she regularly speaks about her trauma, finding the speaking to be cathartic. And with that, I want to thank you so much for listening. Tune in next week when we discuss the wartime film, Tender Comrade. You can follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and Stitcher at Service on Celluloid. Be sure to rate and review us on Stitcher and iTunes if you like what you hear. While I'm at it, I'd like to thank those who have taken the time to review us. Your comments keep us going. Special thanks to Paul and Zacumen for their recent reviews. I'd like to thank everyone who made this podcast possible, our producer, Tessa Jaeger, in Music Shed Studios here in New Orleans. This has been a production of the National World War II Museum.